All right then. Hopefully you've watched my two short videos on how not to write exception handlers. Now finally, I'm going to share with you my ideas for how to do it right. How to correctly write handlers for exceptions that occur in your PLSQL code so that you get all the information you need to diagnose and fix the problem as quickly as possible. The most important element of handling exceptions right is to create a single error logging procedure that everybody calls in their exception handlers to do most of the work for you. And that error logging procedure is almost always going to be built around a table to store your error log information. Here's a very basic example of an error log table. I'll show you a more elaborate version that's used by the open source logger utility. And you can make it as sophisticated or as basic as you'd like. But the core thing is that you're keeping track of the information passed in by the user, when it happened, who did it, and then specific error information. How did I get there in my code? What was the error message or stack? What's the line number on which the error occurred? So I'm going to put this table in place in my schema. And then I'll build a procedure around it. Again, this is a very basic procedure, but it gets the main points across. First of all, the only thing you pass in through the procedure is the information that the procedure itself cannot get. So notice it gets the call stack, it gets the error stack, it gets the backtrace, and there's even more that could be obtained automatically for you. You don't pass that in every time you log an error. You're going to pass in information about the application state, primarily through this information column. Okay, so you minimize the amount of information each developer has to code when they call the error log handler, the error logger. Second of all, you make the procedure an autonomous transaction. What this means is that I can insert this row into the error log or do inserts, deletes, updates, whatever, and then I commit. And that commit only commits the changes made in this one procedure. And the outer procedures or the outer changes in my session are not committed or rolled back. That's key because you want to be able to save your error information even if later on you roll back your business transaction. So keep your interface very simple. Make sure it's an autonomous transaction. Do the insert into the log table and then commit. Not much to that. Let's compile it. Great. Now let's try it out. So here's how I would use it in my procedure. Notice that my procedure has a single parameter and a local variable. Okay, so I write my application, then I include my exception handler, and I call my log error procedure. So there's my title. I had a failure in my procedure. Here's my information. So I'm going to construct a string that contains my parameter value and my local variable. Now this is key because while inside the logging error procedure, I can call the backtrace function and the call stack function to get sort of global information about my session. This local variable value disappears as soon as I leave this block. So this local state in my application will be gone unless I explicitly log it. Also, I might have an application with 100 different variables in it, or sorry, a single program with 100 different variables in it. I don't need to log every one of those when an error occurs. So I, as the application developer, need to know what's important to store and pass along for later diagnosis. So I call the log error procedure. It inserts, it commits. Then I raise the exception, I pass it back out to the enclosing program. Compile that. And then I'll run it. So I run my procedure. And notice it's going to fail. It failed with a program error exception. Well, that makes sense. I trapped every exception. I logged my error, but then I re-raised. So that's expected. Now the question is, can I see my error log information? And because it was an autonomous transaction and the insert was committed, I can still see that information, even though a rollback did occur when this procedure failed and the exception came all the way out unhandled. That forced a rollback. So my information was saved. I can now go back and look at it. I can diagnose the error and fix the problem. So those are the core steps to follow in building a reasonable and reasonably robust error logging procedure. Now, you could get fancier. So rather than build your own, which doesn't take a lot of time, but still, as you get into it, you find there's more and more you want to do, you can use an existing utility. So if you go to github.com and look for the logger utility, you'll find a pre-built and quite popular logging functionality. And just to give you a sense of how things can be a bit more elaborate, this is the table that they use inside Logger for tracking information. And you can log both errors, information, warnings. It's a much more generalized framework. But if we look under the covers in the Logger package body, it looks quite similar. Here's the insert into the Logger logs table. It passes in a bunch of information. It's an autonomous transaction. And then it gets additional information as needed. So right here, I'm going to do the insert into the table. And notice now, it's going to go out and grab additional information. So it's using the system context to get user environment information. So not just the user that's currently connected to the application, but much more detailed information about the user environment. This is already having the format backtrace and call stack passed in, so you don't see it in this level. If we look at log error, then you see where that information is retrieved, put into strings, and then passed in to the generic logger procedure. So it's all the same basic idea. It becomes a question of how sophisticated you want or need it to be. Alrighty then, let's sum up how to handle exceptions properly. First of all, every developer should call the same error logging procedure in their handler, either something homegrown or something you find elsewhere. That procedure should then call all the exception handling built-ins, like getting the call stack and the format stack and the backtrace, anything else that is independent of the context in which the handler was called. But you, the application developer, when calling the handler, decide what else needs to be passed in from the local context. Make sure that procedure is an autonomous transaction. And again, if you can find an existing utility that works well enough for you, and I don't see why Logger wouldn't handle your needs, and you're allowed to install that open source utility in your environment, go for it. Don't spend your time rebuilding something that people have already built many times over. Hope you enjoyed my series on how not to and how to properly handle exceptions in PL/SQL, and good luck in your future Oracle database development.